Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us here at RUSI today, so early in the morning as well, and for our discussion on hybrid threats in Europe, lessons and responses. My name is Virla Nauens. I'm a research analyst in the International Security Studies Department at RUSI. I focus specifically on the Asia-Pacific region, which is very small, and there is, of course, not much going on there. But I look specifically at Northeast and Southeast Asia. In this age of fake news, cyber espionage, cyber attacks, and little green and blue men, it is easy to feel as if we are facing an unprecedented challenge and entering unknown territory in the field of international relations and defense and security. If we were to believe the media, it would also appear that we are entirely unprepared to meet the challenges that we face today. However, that brings me to the topic of today's event, really, and that is threefold. The first is to have an open discussion as to what hybrid warfare and hybrid threats really are, whether it really is something new that we're facing, or whether this is something that we've seen before, but just something that is used with new technology. Secondly, we're going to look at examples from our own neighborhood in Europe, but also beyond. The Asia-Pacific region in particular has faced their own challenges with hybrid threats, whether it's information and influence operations, as we've seen being discussed in the media at the moment, particularly in the context of Australia and New Zealand, or whether it's the maritime militia in the South and East China Sea. Ultimately, the purpose is to think of some lessons that we've learned here in Europe and some responses that we've come up with, if any, that are effective in addressing our challenges, but also to offer some insights and to have a bit of a discussion as to what we can learn and what we can offer in terms of potentially best practice or advice for other countries in the world facing these challenges. So is this applicable and is this transferable to the Asia-Pacific context? I have two quick announcements, housekeeping announcements. The first is that we will be working today and discussing today under RUSI rules, which means that the presentations are on the record, but the question and answer sessions are strictly off the record. Second of all, if there is any sort of emergency or fire drill or something, our RUSI staff will point you the way towards the exits and make sure we get out of the building safe, but highly unlikely and definitely not necessary. So that is all that's left from me, really, and I'll hand it over to Professor Malcolm Chalmers, our Deputy Director General at RUSI, and Sir Malcolm Rifkin to start the day off with a bit more of an informal, relaxed discussion on what hybrid threats are in the European context and how we've seen them evolve. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for getting us off to a start, and thank you very much for all the work that you've done to make today possible. It's an incredible achievement to get such a great group of people together in the room to talk about this topic today. We thought we'd start, rather than having a lecture, having a Q&A between myself and Sir Malcolm, and then open it up to questions and indeed discussion from the audience. And I think we're very privileged to have Sir Malcolm here because of his considerable insight into these questions, born out of a very distinguished parliamentary career, culminating in his position as a senior associate fellow with RUSI. He was a member of Parliament from 1974. He served, I think, throughout Mrs. Thatcher's period as a cabinet minister, and indeed through John Major's period as prime minister, as Scottish secretary, defense secretary, and subsequently foreign secretary. And then when David Cameron came to power as prime minister in 2010, he became chair of the Intelligence and Security Committee, which is the parliamentary body charged with oversight of our security and intelligence agencies. He's a broad range of experience, I think, which places him in a pretty unique position to comment on what's new and what's not so new in relation to the hybrid threats which the UK faces today and has faced in the past. As I'm sure most of you know, the concept of hybrid has both a degree of precision and a degree of imprecision, like all the best concepts in security affairs or indeed in academic affairs more generally. But I think what's pretty common across those definitions is it speaks to tactics which combine to some degree military and non-military elements of competitive relations. In this case, I think primarily we're talking about between states. It usually has elements of subversion, propaganda, which may be fake news, but actually sometimes the most powerful propaganda is true news. So it's propaganda, subversion, sometimes the use of armed men of uncertain provenance, certainly something we've seen recently in relation to Russia. And it also often speaks to military activity, which is somewhere below the perceived threshold for wider escalation. So it has a military element as well as a non-military element, but it's not so much talking about direct military war fighting. It's more about the role of the military, I think, in that, in combination with non-military elements. And the first question I wanted to ask Sir Malcolm to address, if he can, is before moving on to the experience in Europe and Asia over the last 5 or 6 years, is really to ask him perhaps to reflect on his experience going right back as a parliamentarian to the height of the Cold War and that period during the 1980s, but perhaps also subsequently, and ask whether he can think of examples of hybrid tactics being used by the UK's potential adversaries or competitors, and have his reflection from that experience as to what's most likely to work or not work from the point of view of an adversary, what seems to work if you're using hybrid tactics, and what works and doesn't work from the UK's point of view. How do we as a UK respond to such tactics? So it's a very general question, but designed, I think, to draw on your very considerable experience. Sir Malcolm.
Thank you very much indeed, and let me straight away try and respond to the points that you have begun with. And it's always wisest, particularly in a gathering like this one, to start with Clausewitz. When Clausewitz famously remarked, war is a continuation of politics by other means. He didn't say it was the only other means, he said it was a other means of continuing some political issue, some political divide. And I start with that quotation because ultimately we have to remind ourselves that what we're discussing isn't war, it's politics. It's how international political issues are best resolved, and that military means have always been only one option which is available to governments and to the powers that be. Now, you asked me in your introductory comments to reflect on my own experience and the relevance of that to the issue we're discussing this morning. Well, I'll give you one massively relevant example of hybrid warfare. It was called the Cold War. Mm-hmm. Because as we all recall, the Cold War, thankfully, never became a hot war in the normal sense of that word. And whether it was about the future of Berlin, West Berlin, whether it could survive as a Western enclave in the middle of the Soviet bloc, or whether it was the way in which both sides tried to influence Africa, Asia, Latin America to take sides in that dispute. Overwhelmingly, that was not done by military means. There were military exceptions, but overwhelmingly, it was done by a whole host of diplomatic, political, economic, and other measures. So let's take as a given that hybrid warfare, there's nothing new about it. It goes back probably several thousand years in various forms. But what's different? I mean, what's going to be more interesting today is what's relevant today. Has it changed in some way? And I think it has changed in several ways. I think, first of all, what we have is far less, and this may seem a controversial remark, right? When you think about it, I think it's true. We have far less conventional wars than we've had in over many centuries. If by conventional wars you mean one state sending its army over the border into another state in order to either coerce that state or to take over its territory. We've had examples of that, but pretty few. And certainly very few involving European countries or the Western world, as we normally call it. And even in Africa, Asia, Latin America, it's been relatively exceptional. But that's not because there's been any shortage of disputes. And the reason, I think, why people are now, governments as well, are now trying to combine the military option as, as it were, the last resort with other measures of coercion is partly the force of their own public opinion in their respective countries, even in authoritarian systems. We know perfectly well that Putin, for example, in Russia, one of his main constraints in Ukraine is not just Western sanctions or the Ukrainian military, but the prospect of body bags going back to Moscow. And he has support from his public on the basis that that is either not going to happen or very unlikely to happen, except in a very occasional sense. So it's partly the force of public opinion. It's partly the realization after two world wars that even before you contemplate nuclear weapons, conventional wars nowadays result in massive casualties, huge casualties, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, as we've seen in the major wars of the 20th century. And therefore, it's not something simply restricted to armies, which again places a constraint. But thirdly, as my final comment to your opening question, we've also had the extraordinary way in which technology nowadays is so developed, whether it's cyber technology or the means of that kind, that you can use it as a means of subverting your enemies and advancing your cause. So one final point, if I may, because Russia, I think, will feature in our discussions. I remember reading how in the late 19th century, someone remarked that Russia, the then Russian Empire, had only two friends, its army and its navy. Someone recently said today you could say that Russia only has two friends, its oil and its gas. And of course, that is because these are not just economic assets, but they are almost openly, they are not completely openly, used as political weapons to try to force other countries to adapt their foreign policies accordingly.
That's very interesting, Sir Malcolm. And I wonder whether I could just press you a bit about, in a way, the history you're telling there, because I thought it was very interesting that the factor that you highlighted right at the beginning, perhaps to explain a greater emphasis on hybrid in recent decades, was the decline of conventional cross-border warfare, which I guess most scholars would say that that's particularly identified with the post-World War II settlement. Really, it was 1945, or the years immediately after 1945, that established a pretty strong norm against the use of force to change borders, which...
Could I just come in straight on that point?
Sure.
I think you're right, but I think there's an additional point as well. When you look around most of the world, there aren't actually many frontier disputes. There aren't, you know, there used to be a hell of a lot in the 18th, 19th centuries. If you think in terms of Europe or Latin America, or even Africa, you know, or Asia, there are. You have to think quite hard to find a dozen serious frontier disputes between states that could lead to a military confrontation. They still exist, but they, as compared to previous centuries, they're relatively few. Partly because frontiers are now have been defined by treaty, by agreement,
yes,
over the last century, but partly also because the price of a military response to a frontier dispute has been too difficult.
But many of those disputes have been settled because the military, the military option is less available. If you go back to the early 20th century, late 19th century, there were many,
but they have been
cross-border invasions and changes in border as a result of force. In a sense, Africa, classic example where very arbitrary colonial borders were nevertheless accepted as a given.
But most of the internal conflicts we're dealing with at the moment and over a good number of years, have either been because of civil wars of a classical kind, mm-hmm. Whether in Bosnia or in Syria or various other places, or they have been because of terrorist organizations, mm-hmm. Or other organizations that have not been organs of a state, but which have nevertheless been responsible for insurrection, which have sometimes been purely national and sometimes have had international responses. That's different.
It is. I think that, of course, there have been a number of interstate wars over the last couple of decades, including wars of intervention. So our country has been involved in wars against the governments of Iraq and Serbia and Afghanistan and Libya. Russia was involved in a war against the government of Georgia and Ukraine.
Sure.
And we can think of other examples. But in most, though not all, in most of those cases, the purpose was to change the regime of the country in question, rather than to change borders. So, of course, Crimea is an exception.
And with the exception of the two Iraq wars, the Gulf War and the war to get rid of Saddam Hussein, most of these interventions were actually of a very constrained kind. They normally involved air power, sometimes subject to UN resolutions, and even in the cases that we've been discussing, it was very difficult for governments to even contemplate boots on the ground in any sense to resolve a problem. It was done in Iraq because they thought they could do it very easily and very quickly, which they did do very quickly, but we all know the consequences once they finished the military component.
But I think it would be fair to say, wouldn't it, that in many of those wars of intervention, hybrid tactics have also been very relevant. I was thinking back to the Iraq or Afghanistan campaigns from a UK point of view, there was an emphasis on a wide range of tactics. It wasn't only about military, was it? A whole range of other tactics.
Well, I think that's right. If I remember when I was Defense Secretary in the early 1990s, that was after the Gulf War, but the decision was taken to impose a no-fly zone over large parts of Iraq in order to protect both the Kurds and the Shia in the south of the country. And then, and during those years, by a combination of limited use of air power plus economic sanctions, they were actually quite successful in preventing further aggression by Saddam Hussein, which was one of the reasons why the ultimate war wasn't necessary, in my view.
And that brings me, I guess, to another related point, which is that often during this period, particularly in those wars in which the UK and its allies were involved in intervention against powers with much weaker conventional capability, our opponents were often most successful when they adopted strategies which were at the time and today still called asymmetric. So they used military capabilities which got beneath our skin, made it more difficult for us to respond, perhaps sometimes provoked a retaliation from our side that then made things worse. And I'd be interested in your observation about how the concept of asymmetric tactics, asymmetric conflict, relates to the concept of hybrid tactics.
I think we've got to be clearer as to what distinction we draw between asymmetrical and hybrid warfare. And I think, without wanting to commit myself too strongly, I think asymmetrical is just one form of hybrid warfare.
Okay.
And I think it arises in overwhelmingly, perhaps not 100%, what we call asymmetrical is almost entirely where you have one party, which is a sovereign state with all the normal military capability available to it, and the other is either an insurrection or a terrorist an insurrection like ISIS or Al-Qaeda, or it's not necessarily a terrorist group, but like the Taliban in Afghanistan, inherently infinitely weaker in conventional military sense, or Hezbollah in Lebanon. So you have a series of organizations far more in existence now than they were in previous times, which are very well equipped militarily, but do not have it normally air power, and do not normally have heavy artillery, not sometimes they might. And therefore there is a basic asymmetric distinction between the maximum military capability they have and the people they're fighting against. And so the objectives they have set themselves, they know they can never defeat the Americans or whoever it might be in a conventional sense, but nor can they, but what they can do is ensure they are never defeated. So as we've seen with the Taliban, as we've seen with other organizations in various parts of the world, it has proved very difficult and quite often impossible to eradicate even a far weaker organization because it fights in a different way. It doesn't present all its forces on one occasion for a grand battle, which will mean somebody will win and somebody will lose. It fights to survive.
But isn't it the case, I take the war in Iraq and Syria today.
Today, yes.
And look at how Iran operates. So a state actor, but one that in conventional terms isn't that powerful, but is sponsoring allied militia, using the IRGC, using a range of capabilities to pose an asymmetric threat to some of its opponents. Doesn't that sometimes happen?
You can have a powerful state which often will not use its full power because of political reasons, diplomatic reasons, reasons of potential embarrassment, not because it doesn't have that power in the first place. So I think you have to distinguish between organizations like the Taliban or Hezbollah or ISIS, which have military capability, have the capability to damage, to kill, but are not comparable in their capability to the people they're fighting against. On the other hand, you have not just the Iranians, but you could say the same with the Russians. The Russians have gone for a much more holistic approach to their full spectrum of capabilities. The so-called Gerasimov Doctrine is basically, here you have the chief of the general staff of the Russian military saying, as far as we're concerned, our doctrine should be, we don't use our army to fight conventional wars. We simply use them as part of a whole spectrum of responses, economic measures, withholding energy supplies, cyber attacks, propaganda, and military capabilities, some of which we might use openly, others of which we will deny through the little green men syndrome. Now that is, why is Russia doing it that way? I think it's doing it that way for very specific reasons. I think first of all, because it recognizes that unlike during the Cold War, in purely conventional terms, it is weaker than NATO, which is also why they have more reliance on their nuclear weapons, whereas it used to be the other way around. I think it's partly for that reason, but I think it's partly also because Putin's whole position of strong popularity in Russia has been based on his apparent ability to deliver results without deaths and body bags and major confrontation with the West.
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. That it's a combination of those two factors, relative military weakness at a conventional level on the one hand, although not a nuclear level clearly, an awareness of the domestic political costs of high levels of casualties.
And the international costs, because he knows that if, for example, he was to admit in Ukraine that the whole problems of the Donbass could not exist without Russia openly supporting them, but denying they're doing so, if they were not to deny that, then it would make their position at both the United Nations and internationally much weaker than it currently is.
But doesn't everybody know what the Russians are doing?
Yeah, but you know, that is true, but it's a funny thing about international political issues. You know, if China was to admit we persecute the Tibetans, you know, or that we, other things of that kind, it would damage China internationally. At the moment, people who want to be friendly to China can say, well, there's controversy about exactly what the relationship is. Or people who want to have a good relationship with the Russians for other reasons find it easier to justify their doing so. And we found that during the Cold War. You know, that's what many who were not communists, but who were quite enthusiastic about the possibilities of the Soviet Union offering an alternative to capitalism, they turned a blind eye to the gulags and to the purges and so forth because the Kremlin denied they ever happened, and that suited them down to the ground.
I at the Munich Security Conference at the weekend, it was very striking where Foreign Minister Lavrov from Russia addressing the cyber issue in relation to the United States, said that Russia was much more sinned against than sinned, and produced a rather dubious statistic about the Russia being subject to many more cyber attacks from the US than vice versa.
He might be right. Who knows?
Who knows? And of course, it's one of those. But that's the beauty of the statistic, that by the time you investigate whether it's right or not, yes, then he's gained some positional advantage.
We've touched on cyber. Can I just make an additional point? I mean, don't have to make it now, but I think it's a point worth making at some stage. We assume that cyber is something which is used against us and which is very, very dangerous and could have very serious consequences, all of which is true. But it's worth reflecting on the fact, not only that the West almost certainly has used cyber in some ways in comparable circumstances, but that it might have been highly desirable for them to be 100% successful. Let me give a couple of examples of what I'm talking about, very briefly. What's known as Stuxnet, when it is assumed it was the Americans and or the Israelis, or both of them, that managed through cyber offensive methods to actually penetrate the Iranian control of their nuclear enrichment program and created such chaos that program was put back at least months, possibly 1 or 2 years, by cyber attacks that were actually preventing the enrichment of the uranium to nuclear weapon potential levels. Now imagine if the Americans or whoever it was had been 100% successful and the Iranians had not been able to prevent it. We would have had immediately the resolution of the Iranian nuclear crisis without a single shot being fired and without any risks of it leading to military conflict. Second example, very relevant today, North Korea. We had numerous examples over the last year and a half of various North Korean, particularly ballistic missile tests, failing in the first few seconds. Some didn't fail, but large numbers did fail. And I don't know, and you don't know, exactly why they failed. They could have failed simply because they were rotten technology for whatever reason. But we can assume, I would have thought with some degree of conviction, that the Americans have been using every cyber means they have available to them to disrupt these tests, and in some cases will have been successful. Imagine they were 100% successful. Then end of North Korean nuclear program without a shot being fired. So cyber, and including cyber offensive, is ethically neutral. It's the particular examples that tell you whether it would benefit mankind or be negative and damaging. And we've got to just, I mean, it's an obvious point in one sense, but we've got to keep reminding ourselves of that.
So coming back to something you said near the beginning.
And that's all hybrid. That's hybrid.
Absolutely
stuff.
It is. It's how far do you think in recent years new technologies have transform the range of possibilities people have for conducting cyber threats? Are things basically the same with a few tweaks, or is there a fundamental change going on?
Well, I'm not a scientist, so I can't comment on the details of the technology, but what I can say is this. Most forms of hybrid or asymmetric warfare are done quite openly, in the sense that even if they're denied, you can make a pretty good judgment as to who is responsible for what. If, for example, as happened, the Russians, to put pressure on Ukraine, interrupted the gas supplies and oil supplies to Ukraine, when at a time when Ukraine was totally dependent on Russian imports, the Russians, of course, swore on every possible occasion. This was not a political decision. This was purely an economic dispute or a dispute about bills that hadn't been paid. But everybody knew that actually it was being used, as it was done in the Baltic states, for political purposes. They couldn't really deny it, although they tried to do so. However, when you get to the realms of cyber, it is much, much more difficult to be 100% certain who is responsible for a cyber attack. You can suspect, you can have a pretty good reason to believe, but you can't prove. And that's quite crucial, because normally, if a country is subject to aggression, it can retaliate. But to retaliate, you have to know who was responsible. You have to be able to justify internationally. You don't have to, but you usually want to be able to justify internationally why you're either imposing sanctions or sometimes a military response or or a cyber attack of your own. Now, to a very significant degree, you can't do that on cyber with the same, anything like the same degree of certainty as to who was responsible in the first place.
Final question before throwing it open. Today we're going to have separate sessions talking mainly about the position in Europe and the position in Asia, and I'd be interested in any observations you have in terms of the risks that we face going forward, about whether there are useful distinctions we can draw between Russia and China in regard to their use of hybrid hybrid capabilities. Is there something distinct about Russian behavior compared with Chinese behavior, which means that we should be a little bit careful about applying the lessons from one to the other, or can we do that quite easily?
I think China has a capability of a very substantial kind. I think Russia's already using it. I think what the Russians have done, far more than any other country, including the United States or European countries, it goes back to Gerasimov. They have actually produced, and indeed they have been open about it, a doctrine on which is based a strategy, which presumably has clear ability to plan in advance the various methods they're going to use to try to deliver the results they wish. Mm. Some of them cyber, some of them propaganda, some of them economic, some of them military, some of them fermenting dissidents in the countries they're interested in. But I don't think it's all happening sporadically. You know, I think it doesn't mean it's brilliantly organized, but I think there is an attempt to develop and deliver a coherent strategy which Putin will have endorsed and which we are seeing the results of. Mm. I think it's about time the West and other countries started thinking in a similar sense. Mm. We tried to do it during the Cold War. We had more of a coordinated response using propaganda, using economic measures, using soft power combined with our military capability. We no longer thought it was necessary in the glorious years of the 1990s, and it's just become, I think, more of a priority now.
But how does that compare with China then?
China at the moment has not been using its military capability. It's been developing its military potential. Mm. But unlike Russia, it's not actually been using it. It's had occasional disputes with Vietnam. Mm. It's had occasional sort of border fracas with India, but not in any major sense.
Okay.
But the potential now, of course, is growing dramatically. And that is, I think, if I may make an additional final point before we go public, I think there's a lot of interest in the Belt and Road Initiative of China's. And I think people have not noticed the geopolitics of that. It's been assumed that that is overwhelmingly an economic initiative to enormously boost Chinese exports, particularly to Europe, using rail and road and other connections from China directly through Central Asia to the European Middle Eastern markets. And I'm sure that is part of their thinking. But think what it also involves when they are fully operational in this respect. For many centuries, China's relationship with the outside world has been maritime because of its geography. And apart from when we talk about the Silk Routes of bygone days, that was a few hundred guys on camels taking perfumes and silk and heavy, wealthy objects. I mean, this wasn't mass trade. Now, because China has depended all its essential supplies, it doesn't have its own raw materials to a very considerable degree, and a lot of the supplies, some come through pipelines in Russia, but the rest has to come by sea, and that's subject to potential blockages in a period of high confrontation with the United States or whoever it might be. If they succeed in opening up Central Asia in the way that they are currently doing, then they have an alternative way of getting the vital imports they might require in a tense period of time. And that means they would have more leverage then to do difficult things elsewhere. They would not be subject to the same constraints as they currently are. Now, I'm slightly exaggerating, and I'm slightly ahead of what is actually happening on the ground, but I'm not that far behind.
No.
Because, already most people don't know that there are dozens of freight trains every day, every week, carrying large amounts of exports and imports between China and Europe. And that means that the relationship between Europe and China are gradually going to be looking at each other directly. They're not going to be places at opposite ends of the world. And it's a bit like China and America looking at each other across the Pacific. And for many years, until Pearl Harbor, the Americans thought the Pacific protected them from direct confrontation with Asia. That's after Pearl Harbor, that was no longer credible. Europe and China, if the Belt and Road Initiative goes the full way, could now be looking at each other for the first time in history directly, rather than having to make contact around Africa or through the Suez Canal.
And I think that that's a very astute comment, which brings together neatly the reason why it's such an interesting conversation today, looking both at Europe and Asia together. So we have quite a bit of time for Q&A. If you'd like to indicate by raising your hand to ask a question, it would be much appreciated. Who would like to start? Gentleman here.